Throughout the United Kingdom, children are under assault, unnecessarily diagnosed with a mental disorder, and given dangerous and addictive psychotropic drugs. By far the most common of the diagnoses is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, or ADHD, which can label a child as mentally ill, not on the basis of any scientific lab testing, but by means of a behavioral checklist.
The diagnosis is given on a load of behavioral characteristics. If you're a psychiatrist and you've got a 15-minute interview with a parent, the parent will list all of the worst-case scenarios. All of the statements the parent is making can be ticked off on the DSM criteria for diagnosing ADHD.
The problem with the psychiatrist and the psychiatric diagnosis, there's no verification that there's a disease. You take ADHD or ADD. Well, you know, this is normal childhood behavior under certain circumstances. Bored child, stuffy room, lack of physical activity. In situations like that, those behaviors would be entirely normal and expected.
The diagnostic criteria for ADHD are behavioral, entirely behavioral. There is no biomarker. And the kinds of behavioral aberrations they are looking for are likely to occur in boys. If you went back to the Roman Empire, or even earlier, and followed time through to the present day, you would find that boys have always behaved like that.
To counter charges that these children are being drugged not for any medical disease but for being children, psychiatrists claim without proof that ADHD is a real physical disorder stemming from a chemical imbalance in the brain.
I think if a psychiatrist is suggesting that it is a chemical imbalance that's causing the difficulty, then we need some evidence that that's the case.
You must clearly establish that there is a clear anatomical problem that leads to the misbehaviors, or that there is a clear chemical imbalance that leads. It can't be done. It has not been done.
There's no indication whatsoever of chemical imbalances, and frankly, we've been waiting long enough for evidence of this.
Although the chemical imbalance theory has been debunked by psychiatry's own official publications, psychiatrists still use it to convince more and more parents to give young children very powerful stimulant drugs, such as Ritalin, known to cause a wide variety of serious side effects. Take the example of Daniel Woolvitt, whose life is still impacted today from the stimulants he took as a child.
Well, they originally told us in the beginning that it would calm him down, allow him to concentrate, which would help him at school and allow him to join in with other children.
The doctor told us, you know, that it would help Daniel. We just believed with what they said.
I was on Ritalin for 3 to 13, also I'd say 10 years.
They were constantly putting him on the Ritalin and then increasing the dosage, and you could see the effects that was happening to him, where he was totally spaced out, didn't really know what was going on.
Having chest pains, being sick, getting all dizzy.
There'd be incidents where, like, he could get sometimes violent.
He used to hit you, he went through a phase of biting.
And I do remember keep thinking I wanted to kill myself and all that sort of thing.
And in the end, I just had to phone up the social worker and ask to come take my son. I can't even talk.
I feel that the drugs have damaged him in as far as he's got 10 years of his life missing.
That I haven't got no memory from, because when you took Ritalin, it wipes your memory out, so I don't really have much memory of being on it until I come off it. That's when I start getting all the memory.
You're never told the truth of what it does.
If you can't remember your daily life, you're certainly not going to remember things you're learning at school.
Well, I wish, you know, I could actually go into a restaurant and read a proper menu and all that, because of my moderate learning difficulty I've got.
We were told that it would help him, but it didn't help him at all.
I thought it was just me, but I didn't have no idea it was the drug that was doing it.
As a parent, you're not told of the dangers that this drug can do. Because looking back on it now, I would never have put my son on it.
Statistics show that Daniel is not alone. In 1994, only 4,000 prescriptions for stimulants were written. Today, that number has soared by 187 times to a total of 750,000.
Psychiatrists want the world to think that giving children these drugs is perfectly safe, effective, and well-tolerated. Well, how safe could it be to actually give a child a medication that the oncologists are increasingly considering as chemotherapies for cancer?
Some of these drugs have proven to have very serious effects, far way beyond of treating what they are supposed to be treating.
The use of drugs often affects vital organs in your body, and these organs are gradually being destroyed very frequently by the use of these medications, which in turn shorten life.
You're going to have thousands or hundreds of thousands of extra people with diabetic conditions, hundreds of thousands of people with actual nervous damage, perhaps millions of people with serious nervous damage.
There is also in the UK an increasing awareness that people who become addicted really take years to resolve these problems. So the drugs are often worse than the initial problem which it was supposed to resolve.
This is not science. This is snake oil salesmanship. And it is massive business. It is a huge business in Britain.
Every year, an estimated 400,000 children are diagnosed with a mental disorder and given powerful psychotropic drugs. Enough children to fill Wembley Stadium four times over. And the numbers are growing. Under the guise of a health initiative, authorities are now importing American-style mental health screening programs that use vague and open-ended questionnaires to assess psychological illness.
These screening exams are basically designed to get information to where a child can receive a diagnosis and a label so that they're eligible to be drugged.
They want to control any kind of behavior that they consider to be bad and socially unacceptable. So if a child objects, if a child does something that they consider to be inappropriate, not illegal, but inappropriate, then they want to try to remove the tendency to do that through the drugs.
The use of psychiatric drugs to, if you like, act as a chemical cosh to unhappy children is a sign of our disordered society.
We like to think as a society we look after our children, we care for our children. We're appalled at the whole paedophilia thing that's come out in recent years. We're appalled at that. We're appalled that anybody could ever abuse children in such a way. And yet we're doing this through medicine.
Today, such screening programs are being quietly installed across all sectors of British society, especially to children. And with a stimulant drug market worth over £33 million a year in the UK alone, mental health screening and drugging is big business. The leaders of tomorrow, our children, need your help. Without public outcry, children will not be protected against the plague of psychiatric drugging.
Every child has a gift or a talent. And surely, as a society, wherever we are around the world, we all benefit by developing what is in that person, allowing them to use what they have, instead of sending people into hospital medicating them.
If we looked at other alternative ways to treat them, and we may achieve a better result than just simply giving them these exogenous chemicals.
There is nothing to lose by looking at alternatives, whether that's behavioural management or dietary intervention, or perhaps looking at toxicity in the environment. Where is the problem with going along that route first?
When you take a child and you drug the child, you destroy the child's chances for development. Children need to be protected. They don't need to be drugged.
Hallo. Ik hoop dat u met grote belangstelling naar dit filmpje heeft gekeken. Ik ben ervaringsdeskundige op het gebied van vrouwenmishandeling en kwam zelf terecht in de psychiatrie. Deze film is opgenomen door het Nederlands Comité van de Rechten van de Mens, het NCRM. Zij zijn de Nederlandse afdeling van de Citizens Committee on Human Rights, het CCHR. Maar helaas is het zo dat mensen die contact opnemen met deze organisaties totaal geen reactie krijgen. Zo wordt daar door velen gevraagd om een advocaat die belangen behartigt. De waarheid is, deze advocaten zijn er niet. Bestaande advocaten krijgen hun volledige cliëntele toegewezen door psychiatrische instellingen. Zouden zij voor de patiënt opkomen en tegen de belangen van psychiatrische ziekenhuizen ingaan, zijn zij hun broodwinning kwijt. Het NCRM en CCHR doen hier niets aan. En dat is ook geen wonder, want het is opgericht door de Scientology Church. En dat is een op geld beluste organisatie. Ze willen alleen maar dat ik hen ga betalen. Maar dat kan ik niet en dat wil ik niet. Mede ook doordat ik nou niet echt fijne ervaringen met kerken heb. En ik ben nou niet bepaald christelijk. Daarom ben ik begonnen met het antipsychiatrisch initiatief. Ik heb geen religieuze, maar een politieke opvoeding gehad. De advocaten moeten worden wakker geschud om iets aan deze situatie te doen. Ik adviseer geïnteresseerden met klem om zich bij mijn organisatie aan te sluiten. Er moet extra studie worden verricht en onderzoek worden gedaan. Dat kost geld. Omdat ik ervaringsdeskundige ben in gewelddadige situaties en zelf daarna ben verzeild in de strikken van de psychiatrie, heb ik daar een situatie aan overgehouden waarin ik geen gebruik kan maken van een gewone bankrekening. Ik ben beroofd onder bedreiging van een pistool. Dader Ruud de Groot. Het geroofde bedrag wordt gewoon op mij verhaald in plaats van kwijtgescholden. Men wordt niet één keer, maar twee keer gepakt in Nederland. Dientengevolge kunt u nu alleen geld overmaken naar mijn Skrill-rekening of naar mijn PayPal-rekening. Ik kan hiervan mijn schuld afbetalen en belangrijker, ik kan studiekosten betalen en kosten voor te verrichten onderzoek. Natuurlijk kunt u mij ook spreken als u dat wilt. Meestal zal ik aanwezig zijn op psychicbitwine.com. Dan zoekt u mij op onder de naam Skilla. Of ga direct naar https://psychicbitwine.com/psychics/409644-skilla. En daar kunt u een gesprek met mij aanvragen. De eerste 3 minuten zijn geheel gratis. U kunt een gift storten via bankoverschrijving naar Skrill Limited, ING Bank Amsterdam Nederland, Financial Plaza, Bijlmerdreef 109-1102-BW Amsterdam. IBAN-nummer is NL71-INGB 00090701-82. BIC of SWIFT nummer is INGBNL2AXXX onder vermelding van Customer ID 258-34306. Of u stort een gift via PayPal. Ga dan naar https://www.paypal.me/MarisEternam. I now will repeat this message in English. Ik herhaal de boodschap even in het Engels. Hello, I hope you watch this film with great interest. I am an experienced expert in mistreatment of women, and as a result of that, I ended up myself in psychiatry. This film is being recorded by het Nederlands Comité van de Rechten van de Mens, the NCRM. They are the Dutch Department of the Citizens Committee on Human Rights, the CCHR. But unfortunately, it is so that people who contact these organizations don't get a reaction at all. Many ask for a good lawyer that fights for their own interests. But the truth is, these lawyers do not exist. Existing lawyers receive all their clients by psychiatric institutes. If they would stand up for their patient and thereby move against the interests of the psychiatric hospitals, they will lose their income. NCRM and CCHR do absolutely nothing about this. And that's no wonder, because the founders of both organizations is the Scientology Church. And they just want your money. They just want me to start paying them, but I cannot, and I will not, I do not want to, because I do not have such nice experiences with churches in common. Secondly, I am not exactly a Christian. That is why I started the Anti-Psychiatric Initiative. I was never raised within a religion. I am raised in a political family. Lawyers all need a wake-up call to do something about the existing situation. Those with interest, I ask explicitly to join my organization. Extra study needs to be done, and a big investigation needs to be started. That costs money. And because I am an experienced expert in violent situations and got caught after that in the traps of psychiatry, I got myself into the situation where I cannot make use of a regular bank account. I got robbed on the threat of a gun. Perpetrator Ruud de Groot. The robbed amount I have to pay back. Nothing is resigned. You are not a victim just once, but twice in the Netherlands. The consequence is that it is only possible to deposit money by bank transfer into my Skrill account or to my PayPal account. With this, I can pay off my debts, and more important, I can pay for study costs and pay for the costs of a big investigation. It is possible to speak to me, if you please. With exceptions, of course, I will be present on psychicbitwine.com. There you can search for me under the name of Skilla, or you can go directly to https://psychic.bitwine.com/psychics/409644/Skilla. On that site, you can start a chat session. The first 3 minutes are absolutely for free, but you can also deposit a gift by bank transfer. You deposit it to Skrill Limited, ING Bank Amsterdam, Netherlands, Financial Plaza, Bijlmerdreef, 109, let me see, that's 1102 BW Amsterdam, IBAN number NL71 INGB 00090701 82, big or Swift number INGBNL2AXXX, citing customer ID 2583406, or you deposit a gift by PayPal. Go to https://www.paypal.me/marisaiternam. You can see all the details on the screen. Alle details zijn op het scherm te zien. Ook het websiteadres https://antipsychiatrischinitiatief.wordpress.com. Ik draai even wat muziek, zodat u de gegevens over kunt schrijven. I would also like to point at the website address https://anti and then psychiatrisch initiative, that's written in Dutch, so pay attention, and on .wordpress.com. And I will now play some music so you can write down all the data that you see on the screen right now. Thank you for your attention.
I see dead people.
Hokri!
Zet mijn middelvinger op voor die kutte agent. Ben je zonder die kleren ook een echte vent? Je was zeker weggerend als je geen agent was. Vroeger was je zeker de superneut van de klas. Blijf uit mijn buurt, jij blauwe flikker. Vraag niks aan mij, ik ben geen verklikker. Wat ik niet heb gedaan, deed ik niet met anderen. Aan mijn verklaring kan jij niks veranderen. Je maakt me niet bang om me vast te zetten. Binnen 3 dagen weg, want ik ken de witte. Maar korte metten, wie mij verraadt. Maar die mannen in de blauw, dat is wat ik haat. Zwaai licht aan rood, licht en blauw. Arrestatieteam komt voor jou. Je weet elk moment kunnen ze komen. Nachtmerries over die blauwe demonen. Zwaai licht aan rood, licht en blauw. Arrestatieteam komt voor jou. Je weet elk moment kunnen ze komen. Nachtmerries over die blauwe demonen. Voorwaardelijk proeftijd, zit ik heb een strafblad. Nu ben ik gestemd als een even straatraad. Kom in de stad, voel me fucked up. Junior agent, kijk in de stoer op. Weet waar je aan begint met je mieterige kop. Waar ben je van plan als ik kom met mijn klok? Pis op je kop, ik heb geen genade. Liefst pop ik jou nu weg van de aarde. Jullie zijn voor mij, dead people. Kom maar aan vakken, in het lico. Wegrotten, tot op het bord. Elke keer als ik jullie zie, denk ik zo voorop. Mannen, 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 mannen in de blauw. Stoot toe, komt voor jou. Hai, 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 ook drie. Mannen, 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 mannen in de blauw. Stoot toe, komt voor jou. Is aan mij, want ik heb een kleur gezeur van die kutrecenseur. Wat die andere jongens het hebben gedaan. Waarom moeten jullie bij mij komen staan? 3 keer voor jaren praat ik in de auto stap. Ik kan amper zitten, handboeien zitten strak. Geen grap, zeker geen lekker gevoel. Als ik vrij kom, ga ik weer richting mijn doel. Wat ik bedoel, collecteren en spenderen. Van elke parteval zal ik moeten leren. Harder proberen en gewoon doen. Want de politie zit in de weg van mijn boel.